receive a northern industry, the automotive industry, 30 years on APIs. We will receive Murad Abbas, who will talk about API governance as a fundamental pillar of the Renault Group's digital transformation. We had a lot of questions about API governance today. And yes, now we will see how an automotive group is implementing its API governance for its digital transformation. Hello, Murad, how are you?
Hello, I'm fine. Thank you very much for this introduction, Mehdi.
Yeah.
I'm trying to share my desktop, so sorry it takes time. I don't know why.
You know, it takes, good stuff takes time, right? It's like a...
Thank you.
It's like
thank you very much. Do you see my office? Do you see my presentation right now?
Yeah, we see your presentation. Can you go full screen? Perfect, your full screen. Yeah. It's clear.
Thank you very much. So first of all, I would like to say to everybody that I'm very, very happy to be with you today. We are proud to share what we've done in Renault organization around the API governance. And the aim of this presentation today is to explain you what we have done, what is our API governance first, and why this governance is finally a fundamental pillar of Renault Group's digital transformation. So first, guys, what I would like to do is to come back 3 years ago try to explain you to understand what were the root causes of this governance. So we wanted first to break data silos between our business units because we were and we are still very convinced that the data is an asset for our company. Data has a real value. If you use it within your business units, obviously data has value, but you can reach additional value if you share the data from a business unit to another one. And if you go further, you cross it transversally within your organization, it brings another higher level of value. So to break those silos first, 3 years ago, we decided to set up what we call a data governance in charge of setting up a common language between our businesses. This common language was supported by what we call a canonical information model with identification of data set, with the usage of a common glossary. And also what we've done, we defined or we implemented some what we call single point of truth or repositories or referential in order to have a 360 vision of our data and to monitor and to improve the quality of data. And last, finally, we also implement what an API communication layer, a common one, to share the data through high-level APIs in order to link efficiently and easily our different business units. The idea was to warranty data integrity within all our information system and to avoid also non-relevant replication of data. The second major axis of our API governance strategy was, in fact, to increase the reusability and to simplify our global IS architecture. Maybe you don't know that, but within a Renault IS organization, we have more than 2,000 IS, about 2,500 information systems. And unfortunately, 3 to 5 years ago, they were communicating each other with a kind of point-to-point links, non-reusable interfaces. So our aim was to implement high-level APIs as modular components, as reusable components on a domain driver architecture in order to have a common communication layer to hide all the complexity of our backends to our final customers and to simplify progressively our information system architecture. Moreover, when you reuse your REST APIs, it brings a better productivity and a better time to market because you just have to pick up things that are already existing and use them. And finally, the third major point that we had to cope with this API governance was to open more and more to improve the interaction with our ecosystem. Obviously, Renault, as a car maker, knows perfectly, we understand that to stay competitive in our market, we need to adapt our company to new business models, as we've seen in the previous presentations, and also to new kind of partnership with, for example, startups of the ecosystem, dealers, smart cities, energy providers, etc. And so companies seems to be more and more connected, and even our own vehicle, our own product today are connected. So interaction with the ecosystem becomes mandatory. High-level API is a good way to interact with the ecosystem in a secure way and to maybe to go up to the monetization of the data. So this is, in synthesis, API communication layer and this API governance based on an API communication layer is not a goal itself, but it's a kind of efficient mean to contribute to our business stakes in order to give secured access to our data and services, to simplify also and facilitate the reusability, and to improve our time to market, and we hope so go up to the monetization of the data. So now, what have we done in front of those issues? First, we decided to define what we call a high-level target architecture. This target architecture was based on two major layers, on gray in the middle of the screen. One called API management or API manager to deal with the synchronous communication between our consumers and providers. And the second one, called Event Backbone, it's an asynchronous layer of communication, the same between our providers and consumers. As we are a big company with a lot of technologies, we decided to use for our API management solution the APG Google One, and for the Event Backbone, we have both PubSub Google solutions or RabbitMQ or Solace. And to manage all this communication layer ecosystem and diversity, we have set up something very special called the API and Event Service Platform. And I will go back later on. I will come back later on this specific module that gives an easy access finally to all those services. Then, when we defined this global architecture, we also defined what could be the major pillars of this new API governance to bring this transformation within our company. So we defined three major pillars. The first one is the API management. The second one is the upskilling. And the third one is the tooling. And to the objective of those three pillars that I will detail in the next slide is, in fact, to bring the data and especially the API at the heart of our business stakes. So we decided to improve first the quality of our APIs and the data and services given by those APIs. We decided to have coherent APIs that are totally compliant with our canonical information model defined with all the businesses. We wanted to spread a lot of skills to improve the skills of our businesses and ISIT teams around the APIs to bring more autonomy and then more productivity. Of course, we wanted also to increase the reuse rate. I will show you some metrics at the end of the presentation in order to have a better time to market, to reduce our development costs, of course. We wanted also to be fully 100% compliant with our security guidelines and with the RGPD legal constraints. And we wanted to capitalize on a common API management layer and also on a common set of tools for the acceleration of the implementation of our APIs. So what are those three pillars? The first one, the API management, rely on a transversal API community. At the very beginning of this API governance, we set up a transversal community with architects, of course. We had urbanist architects, information architects, etc., with security experts and with what we call API referent. In fact, we identify within each IS business unit a unique API referent in charge of spreading, in fact, the good practices of the API governance, and to control that we have the same practices between each business unit. Moreover, we defined what we call a standard process. This process covers all the API lifecycle as a consumer or a producer or provider. And also, we define guidelines for security, for design, for development, for documentation, for naming rules, etc. We defined also something very specific. It's what we call the 5-star quality rating. Each API has a quality rating before, after its first exposition, and then we can plan improvements and we can check the quality, in fact, of what we deliver to our customers. We also set up metrics since the very beginning because we wanted to be sure to measure what's going on the APIs, the consumption, the reuse rate, and we wanted to be sure that the digital transformation of our company was really happening. Regarding the upskilling pillar, we have set up trainings, e-learning trainings available in our internal platform, and also presential learning. Training has been made by this community of API referent. They deal with the design, with the developer rules, etc. We have also done some webinar events. We have done also some architecture town halls dedicated to the API with a lot of online videos, etc. Regarding the last pillar, it is the tooling. First of all, I told you in the previous slide that we have set up a transversal service platform. It's what we called internally the service registry that gives access to all our APIs or event within the company in order to enforce the reuse of those services. We have also, as I told you, a dashboard developed in our big data environment that uses the logwell of all our technical solutions to expose our APIs. We have also a calculation of our productivity. I will explain you later on. And we have automate toolings that can check the quality of your swaggers based on our guidelines, our rules. And of course, regarding the different technologies and processes to make pen tests, to edit our swaggers, we have a bunch of tools. So let's have a focus on what we call the API quality rating. In fact, it's a quotation based on a 5-star rating. We have 4 major axes: the security, the usability, the consistency, and the scalability. And this quotation rely on a committee that is called the API Governance Board Committee. This, before any exposition of an API within Renault Group, it is mandatory for a team to introduce and to have the validation of this committee. This committee is led by the API referent of the associated IS business unit. And in this committee, we check the compliance of your API with the security guidelines, the design, implementation, etc. We check also the compliance with what we call the canonical information model, with our architecture patterns, and we also check if we have a monitoring of the quality of the data delivered by this API, especially if this API is coming from a single point of truth of a scope of data of the company. And we also make some performance measurement to ensure that our client will not have issues on production. Regarding this platform, I told you what we call the service registry. In fact, you can see it as a portal that gives you a 360 access to all our services within the company. So whatever you want to use or consume REST APIs on coming from our APG platform, you can have access to this catalog. You can see also all our events, whatever the technology, Solace or RabbitMQ or PubSub from Google. You can see also all the web services, the SOAP web services coming from our old Data Power platform or our APIs coming from our ESB WSO2 platform and also our file transfers. In fact, with this product, we would like to enforce the reusability of our existing services. And so we would like to increase the productivity. We can follow exactly who is consuming which service. And we can also monitor the decommissioning of our own platform as the data power or our file transfers. And also as a provider, you can manage your contracts, etc. So let's switch to a few metrics. In fact, as I told you at the beginning, when we launched this API governance strategy, we decided from the very beginning to set up some metrics. We don't have time today to see all the metrics we've got, but I selected four of them, just to show you what we have done and how we can measure concretely the contribution of the API to the global transformation of Renault Group. So first of all, on the top left, you can see a graph where we could see that around 2018, June, when we launched this new program, we had about 10 to maximum 20 REST APIs on our APG Google platform. Since this time, we have delivered a lot of trainings, as I told you, and we have set up also metrics, KPIs to the top management in order to incentive development teams to share their data within their own business unit and with the other business units. And so we multiplied by 40 up to the month of November, the number of APIs. Today, we have more than 750 APIs available inside our company. On the bottom left graph, this is our measurement. It is a monthly measurement of the reuse rate. So in orange, you can see our old SOAP web services. And on the abscess axis, you can see the number of consumers of those services. As you can see in orange, the majority of our services had only 3 to 5 years ago, one consumer, very few, 26 has two different consumers, and only six has three consumers. So with this metrics, with this report, we could see easily that we were in a point-to-point architecture with a very low reuse average. The average of a consumption of a SOAP web service was about 1.2 different consumer consuming one web services. And in yellow, it is our REST APIs based on our APG platform. And it is not at all the same reuse rate. You can see that we have a lot of APIs that has within our company or with external consumer more than three consumers, four. And we have also about 40 services that has more than 10 consumers. And believe me, some of them has more than 100 different client consumer. So for us, the average today is between 5 to 6. We think that we could do better, but We started with an average of one. So for us, this strategy based on APIs in a common layer platform with good quality and design controls brings its first result. If we have a look on the top right graph, you can see, in fact, the numbers of calls done in our APG platform. When we started around mid-2018, we had less than 500,000 calls per day. And then, with all this API governance rollout, finally today, we reached several times the 30 million calls per day on our platform. So this means that this those APIs are really used, and the increase is not linear. Linear is maybe a bit exponential. And by the way, on the graph, you can see the effect of the lockdown, the COVID-19 of this year. And just after this crisis, even if we are still in this crisis, we can see that our customers are really consuming a lot and it's still increasing. And I told you at the beginning of the presentation that one of the aim of this strategy was to improve the productivity of our development teams, either internal or partners. And we have a measurement, we have done a measurement of this productivity within each business unit based on what we call the function point. And we have identified an average of 22% of development productivity directly linked to the usage of our APIs. In terms of trainings, webinar, etc., we trained about 2,000 persons within our organization, both ISIT and business teams. We defined a common API management tooling and that supports all our developers for the whole life cycle of our APIs. And our next step now is to increase strongly the interactions with our ecosystem and to go deeper and to start a strong monetization strategy. So that's it for my presentation today. I hope that it was clear enough. Maybe we can switch to the question answers, Mehdi.
Yes, Maura, thank you very much. We actually have a question from Philip, who had the API, who leads API governance at Dun & Bradstreet. And he asked you the question, how do you, so please, if you can unshare your screen, so like we can see our, yeah, that's perfect. Philip is asking how, let's say the rating, the 5-star rating that you are putting, does affect the productivity, because he said you say that actually productivity increases, but you know, at least this kind of strong governance by quality sometimes reduce productivity.
Yeah, so it's a good question. So thank you for the question. In fact, we don't want to stop the productivity in terms of development teams. So today, what we consider that an API that has more than 3 stars is a good enough quality API. So we don't want necessarily to have 5 stars and to be compliant on all the 4 criteria. And even in each criteria, I told you this, the scalability, et cetera, the security, we have different levels. So we are not blocking and we are not too hard on these criteria. Even for business reasons, we accept to have to expose some APIs, even if they are less than 3 stars. We try to avoid that today, but in fact, we have about 40% of our 800 APIs that has more than 3 stars, and the others hasn't good enough quality, but it helps the businesses, so that's okay. For us, it's more pedagogy. We'd like to show to the development teams that they have different axes to improve their APIs and to help them to find how to improve their APIs and the quality of their services. That's it. I think that
for this question. Last 20 seconds, right? Question from Jonathan. What does the API with 100 plus customers do?
Oh, he's very curious, this guy. Okay, so maybe we have APIs, for example, to manage our leads with a lot of our partners in sales and marketing. And so those APIs are widely open between regions, countries, etc. So we have a lot of consumers of those APIs. And for example, a very basic API that is the technical definition of your vehicle. What is the content of your vehicle in terms of hardware or software? Those ones are used everywhere in your inside the after sales network. You want to repair a car, you need to know the diversity of the parts of your car, so you need to consume this API. So this is an example of two APIs that are really widely used.
Yeah, thank you very much. We already have from Jérôme and Marwan about the successful KPIs you showed us. And glad to have you at other conferences to continue the story, right?